Well, welcome. We're excited to be able to hang out with y'all, and we are talking about how global missions partnerships can transform your church. And we aren't just hyping it up to make it sound good. I really believe that transformation takes place when people do that. So real quick, I just want to introduce myself. So my name is BJ Leonard, and I serve here as a missions pastor. I've been here for 13 years. Been on staff 13 years, so I have a couple beautiful glamour shots like Pastor Brian did that you got to see in there when I was much younger, and we were all in our 20s. But so I've been here for 13 years, and I have kind of a unique perspective in that I've been part of the global missions team here, but I now am going to be a part of the global missions team there, you could say, because within about 5 or 6 months from now, my family and I are transitioning to Kenya. We are going to be long-term vocational missionaries in Kenya with CMF. So you'll see the CMF booth right out here. So we're going to be part of the Kenyan Church Catalyst team there, raising up, equipping, and sending out disciple makers and church planters and missionaries from Kenya to Kenya and even beyond. So super excited about that. And I'll share a little bit more about my family and kind of our journey of that as we go along.
My name is Erin McDade, and I actually work for CMF. So we've been partnered with First Christian Church for a number of years. I've worked closely with BJ and his family. Excited to have them come on as one of our missionary staff members now. My role on staff is I serve as our Director of Advancement. That's just a very fancy way of saying I get to help people take their next steps in service, those who go to serve on the field, but also in support. So I come along our churches and our individuals and help them to connect with what God's doing around this world. As a family, my husband and I and our two young girls were in Mexico with CMF for a number of years doing campus ministry. My faith really became my own in the college years, and so we had the chance to serve, to plant a campus ministry that partnered with the local church there in Mexico, and to be a part of helping young people come to know and follow the Lord. I now live in Indiana, though, so not too far away.
Yeah, not too far. And my name's Jake Moore. I'm the Director of Mobilization for Christian Missionary Fellowship. And mobilization, I often tell folks, is just our cute way of saying recruitment. So I handle recruitment on all levels, from short-term summer opportunities, semester opportunities, one-year opportunities, as well as long-term folks like BJ and Mary that are going out to serve with our teams around the world. So on mobilizing, we are partnering with churches, colleges, seminaries, as well as campus ministries to get people out and serving. And what we have seen through mobilizing people to serve in other parts of the world, they come back on fire for ministry here in the United States as well. I served with CMF for close to 12 years with my family in Ethiopia. I was a church planter with the Church Catalyst branch there in Ethiopia. I worked in a very remote part of Ethiopia near the Sudanese border. My wife and my three kids, we lived there up until 2017. And then for the last 5 years now, I've been serving with the US-based staff for CMF.
Awesome. So what we're going to do is, real quick, just want to give a definition for missions. Probably, if we went around the room, we could have about as many definitions for missions as we have people in the room here. So just something we're going to work with is just, first of all, the foundation, the baseline, that God is on mission. We read that throughout the words of Scripture, throughout the pages of Scripture, we see that God has been and continues to be on a mission to reconcile people to himself, as well as to bring people back into a place of wholeness and blessing and being in existence that he created them for. And so we, as missionaries, it's not like we're out, leading the way and God's following us. Not at all. We are joining God. Therefore, missions is our participation, our part in God's mission to seek to draw people near to him, to take the message of Jesus to others, to be witnesses of Christ, as well as to proclaim just his goodness and to worship him. When we are on mission, we are worshiping God because we are honoring him. And so for this breakout session, we will primarily be talking about global missions partnerships. So we'll be thinking about missions around the world. However, we acknowledge that getting your church awake and engaged in missions opportunities right in the community around you can be equally as transformational. And so, if I could put this plug in real quick, if you're interested in learning more about community missions, I'd be glad to talk to you about that at some point. We actually did a breakout session at this conference a year ago on how community missions can be a catalyst for transformation. And so feel free to check that out. That's on the DHF website. And yeah, once again, I'd be glad to respond to emails, talk to you, whatever we can do to help you get engaged in either community or global missions would be great. So real quick, I just want to share FCC's story. So the story of First Christian Church here in Decatur, and it's probably pretty similar to your church's story. I like to say this, is that we hovered between 50 and 100 members for about 150 years. And so that's a really, really long time to plateau. We plateaued for, a century and a half. And we were part of the Disciples of Christ, obviously. And so our missions partnerships were administrated through the Disciples of Christ, through the UCMS, the United Christian Missionary Society, okay? Which basically meant this. Our church sent quarterly checks, quarterly contributions to this central board somewhere that decided what to do. And I was actually talking with somebody who was a part of that, and he said the letters were UCMS, but they used to just call it UCMS because it was a mess. There was no connection back. There was no lifeline. There was no accountability. You just wrote the check and sent it to, who knows, the North Pole, anywhere. And so there was very low commitment. There was almost no ownership. And it was stagnant. It was really very similar to the attendance of the church through those years. And so for our church, there was a spark. And so I want to talk about that spark. I want to talk about what really transformed this church that can transform all churches that engage in global missions. So the first is committing to missionaries. So as I said, our church was a part of the UCMS, and at some point, some of the leaders said, you know what, we don't just want to send a check. We want to know our missionaries. We want to pray for them. We want to love them and care for them. And so right about that same time that God was stirring the hearts of the leaders, once again, this is the church building at that time probably would fit like in the corner of this room. You know, it's so small. But at that time, Gary and Judy Woods were basically coming through town, and I'm not even sure of the connection, but somehow they ended up in front of the leaders, and the leadership said, man, this is our family. We want them to be our missionaries. They happened to be with CMF. And so the church worked hard to get to know them, and they did everything from not just sending money, but sending cards and encouragements and letters, and they prayed for Darren and Judy's two little girls as they grew up. And just a great opportunity to get to know them. Well then, really the next step for our church was to send missionaries from our congregation. So fast forward, the Woodses came through in the mid-80s, so right around 1985. So then, fast forward to like the year 2000, and a couple from our church, Lynn and Dory Kazir, who had three daughters of their own. Lynn was right around 40 years old or so. They had seen what the Woods were doing. They heard about missions. They could see that missions was a value of this church. And so they said, we want to be next. And let me tell you, that was such a powerful moment for our congregation to be able to raise somebody up, not somebody that, you know, was just traveling around and, you know, went to Bible college. And of course, that's what those people do. No, our people were going. And so Lynn and Dory had the opportunity to go. And this is just such a powerful thing. And you might be asking, okay, how do you raise up missionaries? It's not like we just had an elders meeting and decided we need a missionary. And then we waved a magic wand and, you know, somebody was there. Obviously, God stirs in people's hearts, and God ultimately calls missionaries to go, but there are ways that we can encourage that we can fertilize that soil. We'll actually be talking about that here in a couple minutes during the next section, but that was so powerful for us. So think 1985 to 2000, and then it took 10 years. If you ask Pastor Wayne, who was the lead pastor here, it took him 17 years from when he came in 1994 to finally get our congregation, get our courage worked up enough to actually send people to go visit in Kenya. And so in 2010, we sent our very first vision team, and we went and we saw, we experienced, and that was amazingly transformational. And so you think about 1985 to 2000 to 2010, and you know, that's a long span, that's decades. But these three actions, building on each other, created ownership and a commitment to missions. And so how do we fuel that change? How do we fuel that change? And so if we have the spark, how do we pour gas on that flame to just help it to grow? Well, the first was and is when leaders express the value of missions. It was such a powerful moment for several of our elders who were part of that team in 2010 to come back and say, we've been there, we've seen what is happening, we've seen how the gospel is spreading, and friends, we need to pray about this all the more. It's so exciting because when global missions, when Kenya mission teams come back, they are instantly recruiting for the next trip. As a missions pastor, I don't have to go around and be like, hey, does anybody want to go to Kenya? I have a waiting list for each trip of people who want to go to Kenya because they've seen the fire in the eyes of the people who've gone before. And so when leaders can express that, when the elders and the pastors, the teachers, the Sunday school teachers can express that, it's so powerful. As well as preaching on missions. And I'm not just saying preaching once a year for your obligatory mission Sunday once a year. It really is, how can every sermon have a missional lens of value throughout the year?
And it's not just every sermon, it's every time you gather as a community. So you heard me say that my family, we were missionaries with CMF, and what that meant is we had a number of churches that came alongside us and considered us like the Woods, like the Kassirs. Really, they talked about us in the language of being an extension of their church family. And so though we didn't grow up in that particular community, we were an extension of their community. And in fact, one of those churches, to this day, prays for their missionaries as a part of their service every single week. And so to know that it was being valued at that level, that it is part of our corporate worship, I tell you what, when you express the high value at that level, it's something that people take notice of, whether you realize it or not. A favorite phrase of mine is, what you celebrate is what you imitate. And that's what you see happening when you add that value to what God's global mission is all about, that people naturally start to add value to it too.
And so what we see is if the leaders are passionate, and if the leader, the lead pastor and others are passionate, and they're talking about it, and it's just naturally coming up in the things they do and the things that they say, and that really projects, that puts an image, a value out in front of people, and so they begin to pursue that value. Something else that we do is create awareness. I remember a number of events that we've done here at the church, and you know, there's so many opportunities, and you know, the sky's the limit on creativity, but I remember having like missions fairs here, and so you know, like we tried to turn our lobby into Africa, and you know, people are eating ugali and they're trying the food, and then you know, like this was Asia. I remember my wife taking groups of volunteers up to a closet and put them in the closet, turn the lights out, and be like, we need to meet in secret because this is the persecuted church. And then some kid from a neighborhood would come and hit on the door with a baseball bat, and you know, people are getting scared, and it was, you know, it was fun, but also not quite a haunted house. But anyway, but it was cool because people got to experience missions. People go, man, what is it like on the mission field? What's the food like? Because as we all know, vision leaks. If your vision is in a bucket, no matter how great of a communicator you are, there's a hole in the bottom of that bucket. So we have to keep pouring in. We have to keep creating more awareness, more exposure. We have to keep that in front of people and showing them the videos and talking about it and helping people create empathy for that. Another great thing to do is to work with kids and youth. Man, expose those kids to missions early on. Teach them, what is a missionary? What's missions like? Involve them in missions. Get them involved in different opportunities to raise support. I still remember as a kindergartner, we, at my home church, which I'll talk about here in a couple minutes, my home church had a connection in Romania, and we wanted to help the Romanian students, and one of the things that our missionaries said was, they need Q-tips. We're like, all right, QTs for QTs. All right, some youth leader somewhere came up with that, but I remember, QTs for QTs. So we're like, trying to bring Q-tips and money to buy Q-tips. And, you know, at the end of the day, it's not about Q-tips. What it's about is my little six-year-old heart falling in love with missions and falling in love with, man, I can help someone way around the world. That's probably how I talk. Way around the world who I've never met. And God loves that kid in Romania as much as he loves me. And it unlocked. And that's what it does for kids. And so there's obviously focused opportunities with kids where we can really engage them in missions.
Oh, I love this too. And I have a story from VBS. So as a missionary, you know, it's not uncommon for you to be invited to lead VBS at a church. And I loved it. Our family enjoyed it, you know, to be able to have those experiences teaching about what we do and making it tangible and real to these young people. Well, one of our first partners and most faithful throughout our year serving was an 8-year-old. She was at VBS. She heard what we were doing in Mexico. Somehow she was so captivated by what God was doing, and she wanted to be a part of it. And so for our 10-year serving, she sent us $4 a month every month for our entire time there. Can I tell you, that for me, I get choked up about it now, having kids, was so encouraging. And I pray that it was a gift to her as well, to have that personal connection around the world. Also, you know, it's not uncommon for a number of churches that are partnered with CMF, and we've got a couple smaller churches that particularly they're trying to get their youth engaged, their young people, and they've asked to have their youth be pen pals with some missionary kids around this world. And that is so fun to connect those young people with one another. So, Jake, you've got some good stories.
I was missionary in Ethiopia and coming back on furloughs. We were on the VBS circuit usually during the summertime as well, and had a number of churches that maybe financially couldn't contribute every month or even annually, but through VBS they would raise up funding to help us get a new laptop computer or one of our actual plane tickets to fly home or Q-tips, whatever those things might be. One particular furlough when we came back, we had brought back, again, we worked with a tribal group in Ethiopia that wore bracelets, very similar to what BJ's got on, and it's very beautiful, intricate beadwork. And so we had a bag of these bracelets that we brought back and we were going to give to our supporters. But we hit this first VBS in our time, and I had the wild hair of, hey, for the memory verse of the week, if you can memorize the verse on Thursday of VBS, our last day, I'll give you one of the Gumu's bracelets, one of the tribal bracelets.
Which, by the way, is dangerous, because don't challenge a fourth grader, because they will do it, right?
I clearly was not thinking. I had my bracelet on, so they're seeing it all week. My wife has one, my kids all have them on. So come Thursday, every single kid at the VBS, these are kids from the community, everything, had memorized verses. My wife was livid. We had to give away. I had to stay true to my word. We had to give away all of the bracelets that were meant for our supporters, the people that were financially contributing. But I was like, no, we got to give them away. So we give away these bracelets. Fast forward to just a few years ago, I was at a campus ministry in Johnson City, Tennessee, and I had given a talk about going out and serving, and we were sitting around a table having some snacks, and I handed a pamphlet across the table to another young adult, and the young lady sitting to my left says, hey, I've got a bracelet like that. I said, oh, what? Really? And she said, yeah, when I was a kid, this missionary came and talked at our VBS, and I did the memory verse and got this bracelet. And I said, I was that missionary. She was like, oh my gosh, that's so crazy. But the really impactful part of that is she went on to serve with CMF in Scotland as a part of our college university student ministry. And so, yeah, the seeds that you plant with a kid in a random memory verse challenge at VBS can come to fruition when they're a young adult going into college. Yeah.
So as we think about fueling that change, putting gas on that fire, three words that are part of our strategy here at First Christian is to experience, engage, transform. So we want to help our people experience missions. And so not everybody can go overseas. Not everybody can go to Kenya or Cuba or somewhere in Asia. But what we can do is bring that experience to them. And so whether it's up in our First Kids area or on a Sunday morning through a video or something in a lobby or a booth or something, we can help people experience missions. And then we want to bridge the gap and help people engage in missions. And so we do things like we'll have a Wednesday where, you know what, we're asking people to fast and pray. a couple weeks ago, actually a couple months ago, we asked our leaders of our church to fast and pray that it would rain in Kenya. I don't know if you've heard this story. We fasted, we prayed. I looked at the forecast the following week for Kenya, and it was blowing up with rain. All right, I'm not saying that the Decatur made the difference. God made the difference, but it was so cool. The people, our elders, came back to the next meeting and they're like, "Did you see it's raining in Kenya?" We prayed almost like they were surprised. But anyway, so yeah, just allowing people to engage in missions through prayer, through sending encouragement and little gifts and care packages, through giving financially, which we want people to engage in missions. But then finally is transform. How can we be on the front lines of helping, be a part of God's transformational ministry in those places? But also, as we all know, we get transformed in the process. I love the fire that I see in people's eyes as they come back from Kenya or Cuba or other even national mission endeavors, and they are transformed. And so we want to help people experience missions, engage, and be transformed. And so now what we want to talk about is just some of the support, some of the practical ways for supporting missional involvement. And so there are so many great opportunities to build strong missions partnerships.
Yeah, and I think the point in this particular time is just to emphasize that you don't have to go about this alone. God never intended for us to do it alone, right? Fun story about how CMF, our organization, was even started. So similar to what Brian was sharing this morning about the foundation of our movement, the restoration movement, the focus on unity, the focus on coming together for restoration. So it was in the 1940s that a group of college seniors from Manhattan Christian College gathered together, and they said, you know, at this time where people are trying to figure out how to do missions, they were like, there's got to be a way that we can get people from diverse parts of the countries with diverse backgrounds, maybe diverse denominations, to come together and to rally around and support God's global mission, to actually be unified in purpose and mission, because it's God's mission and purpose that we're a part of, not because it's some part of a particular denomination. And so they created a fellowship, specifically Christian Missionary Fellowship International. And it's from there that we have partnered with churches literally around the world. It started out primarily U.S. churches. Now we have churches across this world with whom we are partnered in raising up and sending out missionaries to do God's restorative work in this world through mission involvement. And so there are some incredible benefits and partnering with a mission organization. CMF's just one example. We're very blessed to have a great number of organizations that are even here this week that I'd encourage you to talk to. So when you don't go at it alone, number one, organizations like CMF can come alongside you and help discern maybe your ministry focus. Maybe there's a particular demographic or age group or region of this world, you know, where you feel called to, you feel uniquely gifted as a faith community to participate in what God's doing there because of who you are as a community. Well, we can help discern alongside you and help get you connected. If there are missionaries like BJ and Mary who come out of your church, well, then there's obviously equipping that we can come alongside and help with language acquisition training, help with getting a mentor, a coach, various people, a support network, again, so it's not something you do alone, to come alongside and make sure that they can be fruitful, effective ministers of the gospel. Support raising training. So much of it is building healthy, God-honoring partnerships with others so that together you can accomplish God's mission. And so we effectively train them in how to do that. And then I'll talk about this one too, just the comprehensive care and development that happens. And I so hope that this is one of the biggest things that you feel when you are connected with this organization. And Jake and I can speak into it. But you all know from being in ministry that sometimes it's really hard. It can be lonely. You can feel under-resourced. You can feel overwhelmed. And to have a network of people who are investing in you holistically, that's mentally, spiritually, physically, emotionally, preemptively, to combat any kind of burnout or any kind of different areas where you might be prone to wander, so to say, but also in times of crisis. Haven't we all experienced a lot of that in recent years? It helps to do that alongside of others. And so organizations can help you as a church extend your impact and your care to the people that you love and are partnered with. And then, you know, BJ, you did such a great job talking about the engagement piece. Obviously, we want to see that multi-directional transformation through deep involvement. So connecting you through prayer, helping facilitate vision trips, some shared teaching. There are pulpit swaps that happen, which is pretty cool to do with some leaders around this world. So much that can happen. And no matter what size church you might represent in this room, I would just say, don't think that you can't offer something up. If anything, there are ways that you can gather around with other regional churches. So you're in Virginia, Ernest. There are other churches around you that I'm sure that they might share the same passion that you do, that you guys could come together to create giving circles or to do a trip together. Something that would not only benefit your community of faith, but you collectively as part of the body of Christ in your region. Again, so many opportunities for those missions partnerships.
And when churches come together in network, you will be amazed with what you can accomplish together. To give, to share, to impact. Yeah, absolutely.
But the other part of that in our involvement is actually being a part of identifying, training, and sending out missionaries. Each one of you represent a fellowship of believers in which the body of Christ is at work in the world. And God has uniquely equipped each one of you and the members of your congregations to serve and make an impact for his kingdom. To truly be missional in the places where you're at, but also to be missional maybe in other places in the world. And I love thinking about that first part in the three kind of phases of sending out a missionary, the identifying as actually being a key role that you all play in helping organizations like Christian Missionary Fellowship even find potential missionaries to train and send out. You are the people that have members of your congregation that carry the character, qualities, and attributes of the type of person that we would like to see go out and serve as a missionary. But we don't know them. You do. So that is a massive part that you play in kingdom work happening in other places in the world. Now, what I like to say is that you all, in identifying a missionary and partnering with someone like CMF, you play the part of being a guide to sending people out to serve. And so playing off of the word guide, I have five kind of essential character qualities or attributes that we look for in someone that we see could be a high-functioning quality missionary that could go out and serve. So these aren't skills. They don't have to speak Spanish. They don't have to already know German. We're talking about attributes of the person that can continue to grow and develop. So guide. G would be a genuine, deep faith in Christ. U, an unquenchable learner's mindset. So they're curious about the world, curious about the people around them. I, an interest in people. They actually want to do ministry with people.
That's good to know.
That's good. That's good, right? Yeah, but you'd be surprised. D, a drive for ministry. So they're involved in your ministry, in your church. They're trying to do things in the community. Those are the type of people that we think would be excellent in going out to serve. And then E, an exceptional teammate. So they're a team player. They're a part of your congregation and not just making it all about themselves, but bringing others alongside them. And those key character attributes or qualities are the types of things that you can identify in the people that are a part of your congregation. They might not be fully developed, but they could be something that you could play a part in developing and then helping train them up and send them out.
Yeah, we're saying, you know, they might not quite be a guide. They might be just like a GID.
Lowercase letters.
But also something else. It's not like you're just walking around hoping that you stumble upon someone that has these attributes. You're not just trying to find a unicorn in the woods. What you can do is raise up those individuals. You are investing in them. You are helping to grow guides. You're helping to grow people that have that kind of vision, that have that kind of calling. And then with that calling, you know, I like the saying, God doesn't call the equipped, he equips the called. which means this: if you find people who are willing to do that, they can learn Spanish, or they can learn business's mission, or they can learn, you know, teach. Relationship will be a conduit to support in some way, prayer or other, at some point in the future, but the relationship is almost like the spark.
And I was going to say along those lines, whether there are financial support or not, you can follow along and be a part of someone's regular updates so that you do have stories to celebrate. And you share those stories broadly. It truly is storytelling. I'm not getting emotional. I'm just really joking right now. But it's when you see God's beauty and when you see God's mission at work and people participating, call it out and whatever that looks like.
So this is what I want to do real quick here. Did you have a question?
I just wanted to make one quick comment. I thank God and pray that God would be elected. I had an opportunity to go on a missions trip in 2019 to Rwanda. So, you know, I want to say, you know, for those of us who may be over 50, it ain't never too late to go on a mission.
Never too late. Never too late.
Amen.
Yes. So, well, real quick, what I want to talk about now is creating a legacy of mission. And I want to see real quick, show of hands, how many of you represent churches that are 100 or less? Okay, yeah, churches 100 or less. Do we have anybody that's from a church maybe of like between 100 and 150? Okay, all right. So that was my church growing up. Depending on whether or not the farmers were in the field, our attendance was either right around 100 or up closer to 150. And so I grew up in a small church. I was joking at my table over here. I was related to everybody in youth group, so couldn't date anyone. So I want to show you some pictures real quick. And so real quick here, here on the left, this was my young beginners Sunday school photo. And so I'm the kid with the mushroom haircut there and that cool 80s striped sweater. So the three of us that are, our faces are circled, all three of us went into vocational ministry. We graduated out of youth group and went to Bible college and went into ministry, okay? We were like 3 and 4 years old. If you go across the way, so that photo there, that was a youth trip that we went on, I think, in the late 90s. And you'll see a number of circles there. Each person circled went on to Bible college training and went into vocational ministry of some kind. So starting from left to right, the kid there with the red circle on the left, he ended up starting and working with a ministry that rescues boys out of sex slave trade who are orphaned, and so they care for them. The guy down at the bottom with the cool shades and mustache, that's my dad. So he was a youth leader, just a volunteer. He went on to lead a church camp. The young lady next to him married a guy, and together they are youth pastors. We have a Christian counselor, a teacher at a Christian school, far over to the right, somebody who's a caseworker for foster care, a missionary to Mongolia, a missionary to India, and then a missionary to Africa. Oh, and then the guy in the middle is a pastor. So you think about it, almost 50% of our high school youth group went into vocational ministry of some kind. This was the legacy that we had. And something else that we think about is, so this is the youth group that was actually a couple years after me. We have a couple youth ministers there, a social worker, and then this guy over to the right here was a youth volunteer that ended up becoming a youth minister and also doing some missionary work in Asia. And I want you to see this photo. So right now, statistics tell us that about 1 in 3 kids in your high school youth group will keep the faith, not walk away from it, but only about 33% of high school students are still followers of Jesus post-college and into adulthood. This picture right here of the youth group, 100%. 100% of the high school youth group this year. And you'll see it's not a very big youth group, is it? I mean, not counting the two cardboard cutouts that they're picking the nose.
I just realized that.
Yeah, Legolas was in our youth group. But anyway, so... Yes, they're goofy. They're high schoolers. They do goofy things. But anyway, having missionaries and having opportunities to go on mission trips is transformational for youth, because for them, it's not just a faith that belonged to their parents. It's a faith that they got to put into practice. And so when you begin to develop when you begin to develop a legacy of missions, suddenly the students at your church know someone who went to Bible college. They know someone who's a missionary. And so this is amazing. At our church, Logan Christian Church, from the mid-80s, from 1986 until 2005, every graduating class of high school seniors had at least one student who went on to pursue ministry and mission training and become a vocational minister or missionary. Okay, so looking at this photo here, off to the left, we have a couple guys who are pastors, somebody who is a Bible college professor. We've got a youth minister, a Christian counselor, a missionary to in West Africa, a missionary in East Africa, a missionary to India, and a youth minister. Think about that. Almost 20 years of legacy of mission. And so that can happen in your church as you look at, go to your church and look at your preschoolers and look at your children. Take a good look at your children's ministry. Those can be the missionaries of tomorrow. We can create a legacy of mission that will not only influence our church, but will influence the world for the sake of the gospel. And so to that end, I'd like to pray for all of us. And we would welcome you. We'd love to talk to you here. You can catch these guys over at the CMF booth. But let's pray together. Lord, we thank you for allowing us to be a part of your kingdom, your glory, here on earth as it is in heaven. And so, Lord, we want to participate. God, sometimes we don't know how. Sometimes we don't know when. Lord, you call us to be faithful. You call us to be obedient. To be obedient. God, we know that obedience is success. And so even if it starts at just $20 or $25 a month and some prayers, a small prayer gathering, Lord, we know that that is obedience. And God, we want to be a part of what you're doing here in our community and around the world. And so, Lord, I pray for the churches that are represented here. I pray for their leaders. I pray for those leaders who aren't here that they would be able to catch the vision of your global perspective of mission and ministry. And so, Lord, as we go from this conference tomorrow, Lord, may we go encouraged, may we go empowered and emboldened to participate in what you're doing. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Thank you all for joining us today, and we look forward to future conversations.